And it's a wonderful day to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. I see some folks have already started vacation, but we're glad you're here. And to be able to come and just to worship our Lord and Savior today, we just want to welcome you. Thank you for coming and being part of our service today. We got something special we're going to do. I'm not going to sing to take up time, so tell you what, turn around and say hello to everybody. We have got a special recognition this morning, so I'm going to turn this over to BJ.
Well, as you know, amazing people do amazing things. This morning we're here to recognize Miss Louise Andrews, and it says, Vandola Baptist Church recognizes Louise Andrews for 35 years of dedicated service to our church.
And thank you so much for your service. We really appreciate you and all the work that you've done for so many years in our nursery.
Amen.
What a blessing. Thank you so much, Louise. God bless you.
Again, we thank you for that, Miss Louise. All right, let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for this day, Lord. We just thank you for the opportunity to come to church, Lord, and study and learn your word, Lord. Just go with us now as we go through this service. Lord, just want to lift up our country. Lord, we want to lift up our world. Just move in our world, Lord, as you've never moved before. We need you more now than we ever have, Lord. Just touch people's lives and hearts and draw them closer to you. Go with us now as we go through the rest of this service. Be with Scott as he brings the message. Be with our guests as they bring the special music this morning, Lord. And if there's one here today that does not know you as their Savior, let today be the day of their salvation. In Christ's name we ask it. Amen. And at this time, we'd like to welcome John and Jesse Finney and Jeanette Williams to bring our special music this morning.
And forgiveness, mercy and healing, He'll meet you wherever you are. Cry out to Jesus. cry out to Jesus. For the marriage that's struggling just to hang on, they've lost all of their faith in love, and they've done all they can to make it right again. Still, it's not enough. For those who can't break the addictions and chains, you try to give up, but you come back again. Just remember that you're not alone in your shame and your suffering. There is hope for the helpless, rest for the weary, love for the broken heart. There is grace and forgiveness, mercy and healing to meet you wherever you are. Cry out to Jesus. When you're lonely and it seems like the whole world is falling on you, you just reach out, you just cry out to Jesus. Cry to Jesus. For the widow who suffers from being alone, wiping the tears from her eyes. For the children around the world without a home, say a prayer tonight. There is hope for the helpless, rest for the weary, love for the broken heart. There is grace and forgiveness, mercy and healing to meet you wherever you are. There is hope for the helpless, rest for the weary, love for the broken heart. There is grace and forgiveness, mercy and healing to meet you wherever you are. Cry out to Jesus. Cry out to Jesus. Whoa, whoa. Cry out to Jesus.
Thank y'all so much. Beautiful job. Our first hymn this morning is hymn number 12. Praise Him, praise Him. And we'll sing all three verses.
A blessed Redeemer, sing hallelujah, so wonderful of your grand, hallelujah, and Him, highest archangel in glory, strength and honor, give to His holy name, like the shepherd, Jesus the Lord is shepherd.
we'd like to thank you for allowing us to be in thy house again. Father, we just pray that you will be with Brother Scott. He brings a message. It will touch someone, draw them closer to thee. Also, Father, we pray for the leaders of this country. Father, this country is in dire need of leadership. Father, just lead them down the right road, putting all politics aside and do what's good for this country. Also, Father, we pray for our military, especially the ones that are on foreign soil. Father, let's look after them, protect them, and bring them home safely. Now, Father, we pray that you'll take these tithes and offerings and continue to glorify your name. For it's in thy name we pray. Amen.
Offertory hymn for the month of June is hymn number 18. Let's just praise the Lord. John, Jesse, and Jeanette back to bring our special music this morning.
Oh, 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 oh in this worn and weary land where many a dream has died. Like a tree planted by the water, we never will run dry. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to know you and to make you known. We lift your name on high. Shine like the sun, make darkness run and hide. 'Cause we know we were made for so much more than ordinary lives. It's time for us to more than just survive. We were made to thrive. Oh, 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 oh. Into your word we're digging deep, know our Father's heart. Into the world we're reaching out to show Him who you are. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to know you and to make you known. We lift your name on high. Shine like the sun, make darkness run and hide. 'Cause we know we were made for so much more than ordinary lives. It's time for us to more than just survive. We were made to thrive. Joy unspeakable, faith unsinkable, love unstoppable, anything is possible. Joy unspeakable, faith unsinkable, love unstoppable, anything is possible. Joy unspeakable, faith unsinkable, love unstoppable, anything is possible. Joy unspeakable, faith unsinkable, love unstoppable, anything is possible. Just to know you and to make you known, we lift your name on high. Shine like the sun, make darkness run and hide. 'Cause we know we were made for so much more than ordinary lives. It's time for us to more than just survive. We were made to thrive.
Thank you so much for sharing with us today. And what a joy it is to be able to come and share the Word of God and to be able to listen to what God has speaking to us about. For the last several weeks, we have been looking at the different characters in the Scripture, and We've looked at Daniel, we looked at Esther last week, and this morning we're looking at a very, very familiar Bible story, and it's about David and Goliath. So I know this is not going to be new to anybody today, but we're going to look at it. Hopefully you'll see it maybe in a little bit different perspective. So I'm going to ask if you will please to take your Bible and turn to the book of 1 Samuel chapter number 17, please. 1 Samuel chapter 17, beginning in verse number 45. I'm going to ask you if you will please to stand for the reading of God's word. Then said David to the Philistine, "Thou comest to me with a sword and with a spear and with a shield. But I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied. This day will the Lord deliver thee into my hand, and I will smite thee and take thy head from thee, and I will give the carcasses of the host of the Philistines this day into the fowls of the air, to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. And all this assembly shall know that the Lord saveth not with sword and spear. For the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands." It came to pass when the Philistines arose and came and drew nigh to meet David, David hasted and ran toward the army to meet the Philistine. And David put his hand in his bag and took there a stone and slung it and smote the Philistine in his forehead, that the stone sunk in his forehead and he fell upon his face to the earth. So David prevailed against the Philistine with a sling and with a stone and smote the Philistine and slew him. But there was no sword in the hand of David. Father, we thank you for this day that, Lord, you've given to us. And Father, I pray that you'll speak to us, that Father, you'll encourage us in your word, and Father, that the Spirit of God would have his will and his way in every heart and every life. We ask these things now in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Story of David and Goliath is more than a story that you heard in the nursery or that you heard as a youth. It's much more than the battle of a young man and a giant. There's much more to the story than that. We're looking this morning at a story that is between good and evil. When we think about this battle, David said his purpose, his desire for fighting this battle was not personal. He said, "I want you to know, I want the people to know, I want the world to know that there is a God in Israel. There is a God in Israel." And that's what I want us to think about this morning. That they may know that there's a God in Israel. Israel is God's chosen people. And throughout history, God has not only prepared, but he's also protected Israel. We saw that last week as God protected the Jewish line. But now this morning, we're looking at this story that we've heard probably from the time we were a small child about David and Goliath and how he fought this battle and how he overcome the enemy. But I want us to look first of all here at what we want to call the enemy, because this is a big guy. I mean, depending on who you read, this fellow is somewhere between 9'9", which is just about with a good hairdo, touch the rim of a basketball goal, and 11 feet. We don't know. The thing about it is he was big. He was very big, very tall. As a matter of fact, they say his armor probably weighed anywhere from 125 to 150 pounds. That's how big this guy was. So he's the enemy. But what does Goliath represent? What does he represent here? Well, he's come out and he said, for 40 days, he has come out and he has defied Israel. 40 days is a day of testing. So for 40 days, he has tested not only Israel, but the God of Israel. This one who represents evil. This one who represents temptation. This one who represents everything bad. You could also say he represents Satan. That's who this guy is. And he's come out to try to destroy Israel. Come out, fight me. Pick a person, and if he wins, we'll serve you, which was a lie, or vice versa. But now, notice the other side. You've got the enemy, but on the other side, you've got Israel. You've got God's chosen people. You've got David. And what does David stand for? David stands for everything good. David represents overcoming. David is actually a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ. If you have your Bible, and I hope you do, if you'll turn back to chapter 16 for just a moment, listen to what God does. In chapter 16, David is anointed king many, many years before he actually takes the throne, just like the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen to what 1 Samuel 16, verse 13 says. Then Samuel took the horn of the oil and anointed him in the midst of his brethren, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. Did you get that? He is anointed. And now the Spirit of God comes upon him. That's the difference, folks. The Spirit of God is now upon David. In Luke chapter 4, verse 18, listen to what Jesus said. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He's appointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and the recovering of sight to the blind. David is a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ because, first of all, he was anointed. The Spirit of God was upon him. Second of all, he was sent by his Father. If you would look in chapter 17, verse number 17, Jesse. And Jesse said unto David his son, take now thy brethren the corn and the loaves and cheese. Here is one who is sent by the Father. Wasn't the Lord Jesus Christ sent by the Father to you and me? He's set apart. He is sent. The scripture says in this passage also that David is scorned. He gets to the battle, and his oldest brother begins to say, well, what are you doing here? You just wanted to see this conflict. And so, excuse me, having a little bit of maintenance here. It's my fat head. What'd you do this thing, Mike? Anyway, Eliab comes and he begins to say, why are you here? What are you doing here? And I think it's probably because he didn't get chosen to be king, because if you go back into chapter 16, you'll find where he was the first one there, and God says, it's not him. So here's Eli. What does he do? He begins to scorn David. And you see this picture of the Lord. But not only this, the enemies, but notice this encounter that takes place. This thing that's going to take place in the life of Israel and the life of David. Because here is Goliath, this one who is against Israel, about anything that's good. And so what does he do? He says, I defy the armies of the living God. Day after day after day after day, that's what he does. Isn't that what Satan does to you and I today? You know what he does? He says, I defy you to trust in God. I defy you to trust in what God can do in your life. I defy you to live the right way. I defy you to live a life that's pleasing unto God. I defy you to trust God in what you're going through right now, this crisis that you're going through. Isn't that what he does? He says, I defy you to do that. You don't need to trust. God's not there. He's not going to see you through this thing. That's what Israel believed. They were scared to death of Goliath. Because over and over and over he had beaten them down. And they did not trust in the God of Israel. And David said, I want you to understand that there is a God in Israel who is still there, who still will fight for you. He said, I dare you to trust God. I dare you. See, he always has a way of bringing back the past. Hey, you remember that time when you thought you had me, but you failed again? I wonder if perhaps he even brought back the fact in Israel. And he said, you know, do you remember the time in Numbers when you sent the spies out? And they saw all the giants in the land, and it scared you to death, and you wouldn't trust God. You're not going to trust Him now. See, that's what Satan does to us. He brings back the past. He brings back the failures. But David said, this battle is a spiritual battle. Because we're fighting the enemy. And it's much more than a physical battle. We seem to really mostly focus on that physical battle when we see David, and you know, David takes those five stones, and I've had people say, well, why did he take five stones? Didn't take but one. He had four brothers. Did you know that? 2 Samuel 21:21. Look it up. Had four brothers. Just a thought. But here's David. And David wants to win this battle because of God. Now here's Saul, and they usher him into, because David begins to ask all these questions. What's going to be done? How are they going to take care of me if I do this? He said, well, you get a wife, you get wages, you don't pay taxes. Some of that's not bad, is it? So they get him to Saul, and here's Saul. And remember, Saul has already been rejected by God. That's why David has been anointed, because God has rejected Saul. So here's Saul, and they bring him to Saul, and Saul says, okay, here's what you do. You put on my armor. My armor. And if you ever see the movie Big, the last scene when he's walking down the road and all of a sudden he shrinks and he's got his big oversized coat on and his pants are drooping. I think that's kind of the picture with David and Saul, because Saul was a very tall man. David supposedly was not that big. And so, but he said, I can't use this. I can't use this.
He says, not tested. I'm going through testing this morning. This thing has a shadow that flows on my Bible. That's why I move it out of the way. But anyway, thank you, Lord. So here's David. He said, haven't had these things tested. But he said, here's what God's done. God has worked with me and through me. And there's been a lion and there's been a bear. And your servant prevailed because God was there. God helped me through this. And David said, I'll go. I'll go. See, David's perspective was so different than Israel. Because Israel, it's like, you know, he's too big. David's thinking, how can I miss? He's so big. David. He says, the giant comes with a sword and a spear and a shield. He looked at it through the physical. What did David say? I come to you in the name of the army of hosts, the name of the Lord of hosts. That's an interesting word because it means this. Here is David, and he is coming to Saul. Although it's in physical, but it's spiritual. Because he said, here's what's backing me up, or here's who's backing me up. You got the sword, the shield, the spear, but God's on my side. And this Lord of hosts, it's a term that means the heavenly armies. The heavenly armies. Do you remember in the scripture where it talks about one night with Sennacherib's army that the angel of the Lord killed 185,000 in one night? Do you remember the story when there's a little issue in Israel and the people are coming in and the servant says, what are we going to do? We're surrounded. And the prophet says, God, open his eyes so he can see the spiritual aspect. And he looked in, he saw the chariots of God all around. David said, listen, the Lord of hosts is in this battle. I can't lose. Isn't it wonderful to know that? To know that God is there, that he is with us, that he will never leave us or forsake us, that this divine warrior that we have, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, is going to step in to our battle no matter what it is. Why? So that we'll know that there's a God in heaven. We all go through battles. We all go through trials.
We all go through different things. Could it be that God is trying to teach us that we may know that there's a God in Israel? That there's a God. Today is June 5th, and I was reading this morning where 55 years ago, the Six-Day War started in Israel. 6 days. I don't have time to go into it, but go back and look. And look at the different miracles that God did. Have any of you ever heard of a Six-Day War? Doesn't happen except with God. Here's old David, and you've got this Philistine. He's full of pride. He thinks he's full of power. He says, listen, I'm going to kill you. And David said, bring it on. Come on. Bring it. And so the scripture says the Philistine arose there to meet David. And David put the hand in his bag and took a stone and he slung it and smote the Philistine, that the stone stuck in his forehead. You think he did that by himself? As big as he mostly had a hard head, you'd think, wouldn't you? But see, it wasn't the physical battle. It was the spiritual. That's what we ought to see here. That they may know that there is a God in Israel. When you go through trials and tribulations and you think you're against an enemy that you cannot defeat and you cannot win, we need to understand that there's a God in Israel. And the same God that's in Israel is the same Lord Jesus Christ that died on the cross for you and me. And he is the one who will help you thrive. He is the one that will help you with whatever you're going through, so the world can know that there's a God in Israel. Isn't it wonderful to know that you don't fight the battle alone? That you don't have to try to do it yourself? That whatever Satan may throw at you, there's a God in Israel. And that God is a personal God. And when we invite him into our lives, he comes and he brings all the power and authority of Almighty God with him. And the scripture says that we are complete in him. Nothing lacking. There's nothing that we need. We just need to go forth in the power, in the name of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That's how we go. We go by him and through him, because he is able to defeat the giants. In just a moment, we're going to have an invitation hymn. I want to invite you this morning. I don't know what you're going through, but more than likely, you're either going into a battle, you're in a battle, or you're going out of one. That's how we live life. But are you living and going through the battle by yourself? Maybe you're here this morning, you've never trusted him as your Lord and Savior. I invite you this morning to give your life to him. The greatest decision that you ever will make in your life is to give your life to Jesus Christ. To serve him, to allow him to be the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords in your life. It's through him you can do all things, Paul said. Maybe you're here this morning and you believe God would have you to be a member or part of our church. And what a joy it'd be to have you as a member. As God speaks to you, I want to encourage you to come. Maybe you just need to come to the altar and say, God, I'm tired of fighting the battle alone. I've tried it myself and I'm not winning. But Lord, will you help me? Will you go forth before me and be my commander? Will you see me through the battle? And God will see you through that battle because of who he is and what he's done. There may be other decisions that you need to make this morning. As we stand and sing our invitation hymn this morning, I want to invite you to come and ask now if you will please to stand. We'll pray and then... Everlasting to everlasting. Lord, I pray, Father, for those here today who need to make decisions. Father, would you encourage them? Would you speak to them? Would you help them today? Father, we give you all the praise and all the glory. Father, that's what David wanted. He wanted to give you glory. So, Father, whatever's done today will be for your honor in your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our invitation hymn is 480.
Just a moment, please. Butch, if you'll come up here, please. This is Butch Mays, and Butch is coming this morning. He's been saved. He's coming for believers' baptism and membership in our church. And so I want to present him to our church. So I hear a motion that we accept him as he comes. Second. All in favor say amen.
Amen.
Butch, God bless you, my friend. It is a joy to have you, my brother. And we're looking forward to what God will do through Butch. And I know many of you have been praying for him, so thank you. Just a couple, let's see, next week, 3 weeks from today, we'll do baptism and communion, okay? That should be the last Sunday in the month, whatever the date is on that, okay? So we'll be looking forward to that. And I tell you what, Butch, if you'll head that way, I'll meet you at the door, okay? All right. If you will stand, please. And thank you, folks, for the great music this morning. What a joy to have you guys with us today. And, of course, everybody else, we're glad to have you. And what a blessing to be in the house of God today. Amen? All righty. Yeah, go out there with Butch. All right. Let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for today, and Lord, for the privilege we've had to be in your house. And Lord, thank you for Butch and his coming today. And Lord, I just pray your blessing upon him. And Lord, we love him. We thank you for him. Lord, thank you for the ones that you brought into our fellowship. Lord, we love you and we thank you and praise you now. In Jesus' name we pray, and for his sake, amen.